to what is probably the first monotheistic religion in the world. And this piece by Amir Malakpour, an Iranian-born and composer who lives in Europe now, contemplates that time and the beginning, and you'll hear that ancient sound. You can practically hear the moss on the stones at the beginning. So the first one, with the inner battle, contemplates the battle between Ahura Mazda, the wise one, which is the personification of good, and Ahriman, the personification of evil. So it's the inner battle, meaning the battle inside of us. And interestingly, in the middle of that piece, you'll hear some very victorious sounding music that makes it sound like the battle has been won, but then the piece will keep going, right? Telling us that maybe only temporarily, and that battle continues both in society and within each of us. The second movement, Zarathustra's Prayers, is obviously the time when revelations. And then the third movement, Festival of Ganavar, Persian festivities, you can really hear that you are at a, I think, Renaissance fair, but Persian, and things are happening here, and things are happening here. You'll hear the scene move side to side and place to place. And then in the second piece, also by an Iranian-born composer, Parisa Sabet, she trained in Chicago, and then lives in Toronto, went on to do her graduate work and lives in Toronto, is very, very involved in the kind of cultural and beneficial strengths of music with an organization, for instance, called the Israeli-Iranian Music Group that works to build harmony. So very, very much in sync with our mission here at the San Francisco Lesbian Gay Freedom Band. And the second piece, so the first piece contemplates this time, a long time ago, ancientness, and the idea that how an idea passes through time. So that first monotheistic religion, also a very mystical religion, there's only about 200,000 Zoroastrians in the world today, mostly in the United States and India, but the ideas of Zoroastrianism are all over the place in the main religions of the world, in all the kind of mystic elements, the Sufi, Muslim, and some of the Baha'i and others has influenced the other religions, right? And so how an idea passes through time. The second piece, Nowruz, is her reminiscing about Persian New Year and how she misses being back in Iran to celebrate Persian New Year. So it's more about the passage of time, how we go from year to year. I'm just going to read her comment. Holidays never feel the same in any part of the world as in one's home country. For me, March 21st is that time of year. I wish I were home to celebrate Nowruz, the Persian New Year, with my family. musical perspective on time. So Yan Peng is a Chinese-born and trained composer who now lives in the United States. He studied at the Sichuan Conservatory and then at the University of Minnesota, and is now in the faculty at St. Olaf College. And she spent 3 weeks in her training living amongst the Dong people, the Dong ethnic minority, to specifically study the way that their society interacts with music. And music is very, very central. It combines singing and the playing of the sheng, which is a very ancient, about 3,000-year-old wind instrument of what's called known as the free reed variety. So it's basically a little pipe organ that you carry and blow through. This is like the predecessor of the pipe organ. Wind composers in particular probably the last 50 years, passed away plus a little bit ago. This was his last piece, and it was written for the California Allstate Band in 2016. And I think I'll just read what he says. Music is wonderful. It lets us tell ourselves things we can't speak in words. It opens the dream space and lets us dream together. It lets us imagine the world as it really is, a place of vitality, power, and possibility. We live in fear of destruction from climate change, nuclear bombs, increasing population, vanishing resources, continuous war. When the troubles are listed like this, it's hard to know what we think we are doing in our, with our seemingly simple and innocent music making. California has always been a place of big dreams. The music of California, this piece, celebrates the California dream space. There's tremendous beauty here, the forests, deserts, mountains, and valleys, and the ocean. And also a strength within the people and in the earth to meet the times that are upon us. Music lets us dream, and in that dream is the possibility of a new world, one in which humans live in harmony within themselves, with all other people, with all other species, and with the planet. Is this dream impossible? Are there circumstances too complex? Will human nature never change? My answer to these questions is no. The dream starts somewhere, and let our music making be one such place.
want to share a few of our upcoming events. So coming up in a couple weeks on October 2nd, our very busy marching and pep band will be participating in the Castro Street Fair, so that will be an excellent time to come out and check it out. The following weekend, we'll be marching in the Italian Heritage Parade, and a couple weekends later, we will be performing at the Golden State Warriors LGBT Night. Yeah, excellent, thank you. But one of the things I'm most excited about is this coming December 17th and 18th, is the return of our in-person dance-along Nutcracker. For the first time in 2019, we'll be able to hold it in person. We're very excited about that. Again, speaking about time, today is exactly 1 year since the first in-person concert that we were able to host since COVID. So I wanted to embarrass a few people back here. It's been a really uncertain time for arts organizations. And so I wanted to take a moment to celebrate all of the new members that have come out and joined us since COVID. So if tonight is your first concert performing with the band, go ahead and stand up. Our 45th anniversary season next year. Somehow, 45 years. And one of the most exciting things that we are premiering next spring is our first BIPOC commission, commission from a BIPOC composer that we're going to be premiering in May. It's actually a familiar name if you have taken a look at your program. Roger Zehr is the recipient of our first BIPOC commission. He is the composer of Mare Tranquillitatis, which we'll be hearing in the second half. With that, let's go ahead and take a quick intermission, and we'll be back in a few minutes. Thank you so much.
active piece, I guess one might say, to one that's really quite tranquil and about a place that's about as tranquil as we can imagine. And that would be the Sea of Tranquility, Mare Tranquillitatis. This piece by Roger Zare, who, as you were told, we will premiere a piece by in a few months, was kind of his big first piece that really launched him. And he's one of the very popular composers for winds right now. And this piece contemplates the Sea of Tranquility on the Moon. And if you think about it from the standpoint of time, it really fits in a lot of ways. As I contemplated this piece when I first learned of it, it's like, I thought, well, you know, as long as there have been humans, we have been looking at that spot on the moon and theorizing about what was going on there. So it's been a thought point for as long as anybody looked at the sky. And we think of it as unchanging, but of course it's not. Things run into it. There is a little bit of moon weather, but it doesn't change the way we see our surroundings change. And then, you know, 55 years ago, a big change came when, as a species, we were able to observe it up close for the first time. And I don't know, I imagine for some of you who are around my age or older, that moment is probably pretty indelibly imprinted in you. I remember my family living in Missoula, Montana, and I can picture where the TV was located, and we were one of the few families that still had a black and white TV at that point in my neighborhood, a very old one. Thanks so much for joining us for this afternoon, for this little journey. I'm personally in love with every one of these pieces, and I have just loved getting to share them with you, bringing different perspectives, I think, to time from different cultures and different creators, different composers. We're going to finish with a piece by Arturo Marquez, one of the very, very popular composers of Mexico for the past, oh gosh, 40 years or so. A real favorite of Gustavo Dudamel and his groups. This piece, Conga del Fuego Nuevo, is got a kind of an interesting mishmash. So, if most of you ever danced a conga, it was probably at a wedding. Right? So I think the last time I was in a conga line was my nephew's wedding, and my nephew Ben and his husband Tim are kind of social directors. They're absolutely amazing. And they actually got everybody into a conga line feeling like they were having fun, which was, you know, different. So a conga is, an Afro-Caribbean dance. And here we have a Mexican composer using it entitling it after and kind of inspiring it after an Aztec ritual. So the ceremony of Fuego Nuevo was the Aztec ceremony that needed to take place every 54 years in order to relight the sun so that the world didn't end. Every 54 years, the Aztecs had two calendars, a civil calendar and a religious calendar. Actually, a civil calendar and a religious calendar. And one was 240 some days and one was 365 days. Every 54 years they line up. And so this is where the whole thing of, you know, like, okay, the end of time according to the Aztecs is coming. Well, it was every 54 years. And they had a ritual that was performed in a temple on a very high mountain. And in order to relight the fire, and then that fire was taken out to the other places around the Aztec Empire. And so it's something of a kind of savage ritual. So this piece, if you've got this nice conga, but it's got a little bit more bite to it than that. And in the middle, because he's Mexican, there's a little hint to mariachi, so it's a little bit